we are running a series on English novel, and we have already done two lectures on it, and the third lecture is by Dr. Payal Nagpal, who teaches English literature in Delhi University's Janaki Devi Memorial College, and she is a person of theory and modern literature. And in this lecture, she will be discussing the novel in the 18th century, its beginnings. So I say one or two things about the novel, and then I hand over the charge to Dr. Payal Nagpal. The 18th century is known as the century of the novel in two senses. One, that the novel originated at that point of time, and the second is that this origin had certain historical things behind it. Generally, we see that a literary form is not confined to a particular century or to a particular era. Literary form generally has been there since time immemorial, but so far as the novel is concerned, there was no novel worth the name or the way we understand it before the 18th century, even though there were narratives, there were stories, there were expansive kind of things, you know, that were there in prose as well as verse. But then the kind of novel that we know wasn't there before the 18th century. And we have to go into this, and I would request Dr. Payal Nagpal to tell us as to how this form would have then emerged specifically in the 18th century. So, Dr. Payal Nagpal, please tell us, what is your view?
Thank you for this, Professor Prakash. So, when we discuss, I think, the rise of the novel, and as you rightly put it, that it has to be located in the 18th century. So, I think one of the questions that we need to ask is, why, what was the need, what were the historical conditions that actually led to the rise of the novel in the 18th century? So, if we just briefly look at the forms that were available earlier, you know, the rudimentary forms, in a sense, that can be considered akin to, you know, the establishment of the novel as a kind of genre in the 18th century. So, we had, of course, you know, writers who wrote for patronage, writers who wrote poetry, and you know, so poetry was, as a genre, poetry and drama were both very, very established. But in terms of a kind of, if we can call it a pre-novelistic structure, then we had something like The Pilgrim's Progress in the 17th century, and which understood life in terms of allegories, in terms of morality, in terms of, you know, identifying aspects of human life in very, very clear-cut moral terms, so to say. And of course, we have, you know, the Restoration playwright Afra Behn, who also wrote Oronuku. So, you know, we can, it's not as if there were no rudimentary structures, but nothing that we understand to be like the novel in the 18th century. So, if we were to just kind of briefly look at a few aspects, you know, that kind of surrounded the writers in those days. So, one of them, of course, was the whole idea of patronage, how in the 17th century the writers wrote for patronage. And post this, I think early 18th century, 1709, when we have the Copyright Act, that is when the whole idea of writers exercising greater control, in a sense, over what they are writing, I think, emerged. And along with this, you know, of course, the Grub Street phenomena and the notion of publishing as business, as, you know, an enterprise, which, of course, at times did generate profits and at times it did not. So, which meant that it could be also coupled, in a sense, with a kind of mercantile group that was gradually emerging. So, if you look at these ideas, then if the prevalent genres of the 18th century.
Before you continue with it, I've been struck by the use of the word patronage that you used. So perhaps what you mean is that till the 18th century, the writer was more or less totally in control of the patron.
Yes.
And he or she, mainly he, would be always, you know, drawing money, support, social kind of sanction from the lord, from a patron. But in the 19th century, the 18th century, the writer became on one's own and started asserting himself as a writer, who would have something specific to say to the audience directly. Would you agree with this?
Yes, I would agree with this. And also this happened at two levels. Mm. One was that structurally, because patronage was so very important for the writer. So to actually in a very, very celebratory tone to kind of appreciate the patron and to then in that sense use a structure that was already there became was probably more convenient. But it's only in the 18th century as writers had greater control over what they were writing, and as a result without patronage the possibility of more people to join the club of writers in a sense became a possibility.
So you suggested almost directly that the writer became an entrepreneur.
Yes.
Then a patronized individual.
Yes.
He would now entirely address the audience on his own terms. And he would sell his wares, the fictional wares.
Yes.
Would you accept this metaphor?
Yes, I do. I totally accept this metaphor that, the writer in a sense was the entrepreneur of the 18th century. Because earlier, because of the whole system of patronage, only people who would get a certain kind of patronage would be able to write, and which also meant kind of keeping in mind, the social positioning of the patron, and so whatever the writers wrote had to be within that context. So to bring in a new genre or to kind of really speaking offer a blatant critique of the times, I'm not saying that it was not a possibility earlier, but yes, there were constraints and writers kind of worked around these constraints. But with the advent of the 18th century and the emergence, as you correctly pointed out, of the writer as entrepreneur, this flexibility was much more in that sense in the 18th century.
Mm-hmm.
And which is why another factor I think that kind of is coupled with this is the whole the rise of what we understand in the 19th century, what we call the rise of the middle class and so on, is something, its beginnings are already there. Of course, it starts in the late 16th century, but in the 18th century the mercantile group is gradually becoming a very, very powerful group. And they are able to kind of, look at things, as you said, in terms of a kind of business, and writing too, was kind of coming within that purview, within that category. And which is why it's interesting that we have the periodicals in the 18th century, we have a lot of circulating libraries in the 18th century. And these are the factors that allowed writing to be looked at in a certain way, and the whole process of reading, because if there's writing happening, there are also readers. So the readers, could access whatever was being written through these circulating libraries. And so the entire structure, in a sense, or reading of periodicals, where of course people from the mercantile class were figuring as protagonists. So this actually would be a fitting structure, in a sense, to the novel. A kind of pre-structure, if you were to look at it, to the novel.
And you mentioned two writers, Bunyan and Afra Behn.
Yes.
And you referred to two texts by them, one by Bunyan and the other by Afra Behn. And incidentally, both the texts are in prose. And that was not the case with literature till the end of the 17th century.
Yes.
So did they start using the prose part of language as a part that would straight away connect them with the reader in the 18th century, because now they would be depending on the reader than on the patron.
Yes, which is why I kind of looked at these two texts as providing a kind of rudimentary structure, in a sense, that existed. And now that you ask this, it also kind of strikes me that maybe also because of the Cromwellian period in the 17th century, which also kind of put the ordinary person, in a sense, however briefly, on a certain platform, I think that also allowed for the use of prose in a certain way. And where, of course, Bunyan is kind of, talking about everything, human life in terms of structures of morality, Oronuko is also looking at, other aspects of, expansion and the existence of the slave and so on. So these two texts, in a sense, do provide a kind of structure which allows us to connect it to the reader of the 18th century. And the use of the prose form.
Because, the prose is very down to earth, literally. prose belongs to the earth, to the ground, whereas verse, you know, goes up and is all the time aloft. So are you consciously using this term, you know, the novel as something that is of the entrepreneur and that is of the prose, and that it talks about the reality in the sense of being close to the ground?
Yes, it is close to the ground, and a little later we'll also kind of discuss the position of women in this context, and mm-hmm. you know, how they were not expected to either read or write, you know, in a certain sense. I mean, I have of course Jane Austen and Elizabeth Bennet at the back of my mind when I'm saying this. So in the sense that this was certainly not the norm, but when we look at verse, we're looking at in terms of convention, at a certain structure which is considered to be sublime or lofty. But when we look at prose, it is the language of the ordinary people, and this actually kind of brings me to the whole discussion of what really is the ordinary, and how is it that the ordinary really speaking emerges. And there is a quotation that I would like to just share here, which is by Humphreys. It says, it is the, about the ordinary man in the 18th century. So it says, it is the first stage in which we recognize the ordinary man as the norm. But the ordinary man here is not that dreary abstraction, the statistically average citizen, but a variety of living persons. And I think in just this one statement, there are a lot of ideas that have been put together. First of all, that when we look at the novel as a structure, as a genre, we are looking at the novel as focusing on the life of the ordinary man or woman. And it's not the term ordinary is not a kind of essentialized category which is like totally abstract, but it's a concrete category and is in a sense a sum total of different kinds of living persons and different kinds of ordinary people.
Could you simplify it further? This is a subtle point.
I think the ordinariness in a sense mm-hmm. is not just one a holistic category, but it is full of the colors in a sense of life, of different people, of social contradictions. And so to actually look at it as any one thing and not anything else would be very problematic. So if we try to understand the focus of the novel on the ordinariness of life by focusing, let's say, by making the protagonist a tramp, an ordinary person, or the Picaro, the rogue, or an ordinary woman, be it Pamela and so on. The idea is that it will mean different things. It's not going to be, it has to be studied in terms of the social context from which it emerges.
So you are differentiating the ordinary from the extraordinary, from the person who is up there.
Yes.
And a lord, a lady,
yes.
a king, a prince, a princess. So that's not the only point of concern for the novel. The novel would talk about people other than these. And they would have a kind of variety there.
Yes.
And that variety would be as colorful, as appealing as the variety of princes and kings.
Yes. Mm. In fact, that's the idea. This is what the novel does, which is why it's very interesting. If we look at a lot of the novels of the 18th century, they're all very, very long novels.
Mm-hmm.
And Tom Jones or Tristram Shandy and so on, these are very long novels. And we kind of, because there is so much to write about every aspect of, the lives of the ordinary people. It could be related to, the economy. It could be related to the work that they do. It could be related to the social relations that they form in their own context, the human social relations. It could be, the simple living conditions of which they are a part. So it's many things, actually. And it's interesting that in the 19th century, I think Dickens also kind of, by bringing in different aspects of the ordinary, is kind of taking this idea further, is developing it further. But primarily, it's important to understand that when we look at the novel in the 18th century, one of the most important factors is that the protagonist of the novel is the ordinary person. The language is the language of prose. And it's also prose that's mixed at times with the use of the colloquial. Mm-hmm. And the colloquial, in a sense, is it's the ordinary day-to-day speech of people and the way they would speak to each other in their lives. And it's not something that's coming to us, in a sense about, let's say, the nobility or the aristocracy or, writing in verse. So I think these are really speaking the defining factors of the novel in the 18th century.
So I believe apart from the novel getting enriched with the use of the language, the language also is enriched.
Yes.
Because when you talk about the ordinary people as a novelist, then that language starts, getting more and more expressive about the emotions that exist on the road at that point of time. And so far as the characters are concerned, they can touch all the heights through prose and as human beings than as people, stationed in life at a particular place.
Yes, that's absolutely true. And for instance, this idea about the enrichment of language through the genre itself, through the novel itself, is very interesting, because we don't have, in the novel as a genre, we do not have just one kind of language that is being written, which is why I think later theorists of the 20th century, when Bakhtin is also talking about a kind of plurality in language, these are ideas that are already there. I think in the very formation of the novel, where it opens itself up to many languages and many ways of speaking and many ways of actually, and it's not just language as a kind of linguistic structure, but it's also something that's related to the kind of life that people were leading. So the use of the colloquial or the use of the ordinary day-to-day prose structure was very, very interesting, and it lent a lot of, it made the structure of the novel more dynamic for that reason.
Mm-hmm.
And another, kind of aspect of the novel in this sense that we can already see in the 18th century and an idea that is developed in the early 19th century is that of, focus on realism. Because when we talk about, the ordinariness of life, we are also looking at one of the important tropes, and this trope is that of realism, which meant that, it's of course very different from the kind of realism that we see in the early 19th century. But the idea is that the detailing that is there in the novel, and as I mentioned, a lot of these novels were really speaking very, very long. So this kind of detailing that is presented is very interesting and tells us a lot about a kind of worldview of the 18th century life. And this, I think, is significant.
What would be the general length of a novel in the 18th century? Any idea?
I mean, it could range anything from about 250 to 400 pages. So
even
it could
more,
be
perhaps.
Even more, perhaps. Mm. So,
and such a big number of words, pages, would also involve many plots, many characters, many you use the word detailing, so
yes.
Detailing in that sense.
Yes.
That anything that is there in the life can be mentioned in the novel, and that will come to educate the people about their life, about their conditions.
Yes.
Which is not the case with drama, which is not the case with poetry earlier. There the whole thing is evocative, and here it is telling, describing.
Yes. In fact, here it would be interesting to look at some of the developments of the 17th and 18th century to really speaking understand exactly what is really speaking, what is it that shifts this focus
mm-hmm.
from the lofty to the ordinary. So for instance, if we look at the 18th century, of course, is known for its emphasis on rationality. It's the age of enlightenment. So how does it kind of come about that we look at this element of rationality here? So if we look at the rise of the mercantile group, so 17th century, for instance, has the establishment of the Royal Society. It sees the establishment of the Bank of England in 1694. The merchant becomes a very, very important figure. And we are looking at mobility. We are looking at the mobility as in physical and social mobility of a massive group of people. Really speaking, looking at it from the time of the guild system in the 16th century and moving into the 17th and then the 18th century, we see increase in mobility. And for this reason, there's a complete reconfiguration in a sense of words like honor. So something that is associated in a sense with, you know, the lofty and the sublime, I think that is something that is almost kind of mocked at and, made fun of within the discourse of the 18th century. And again, apart from travel and mobility, as I mentioned earlier, so we have the periodicals and circulating libraries. We have, of course, in the 18th century, so a major text that, exercises a kind of very determining impact is Wealth of Nations and by Adam Smith. So these are just some key moments that show us how the focus is gradually shifting. And there is a class that is increasingly kind of being, there's a class of people that's emerging, and there is a group of people that have held power for very long, and their authority is now being kind of undermined. And here again, I would just introduce another quotation. For instance, this is by Arnold Kettle, who says, "Who are these people?" And he says, "They are the literature of the feudal outcasts, of the men and women who have no satisfactory place in feudal society. And their characteristics are the characteristics of the rebels and adventurers who had not yet become a self-conscious class." So again here, the feudal outcasts, people in a sense, who really speaking do not find any kind of position within the structure of feudalism, and they are people who do not have a satisfactory place there. These develop certain characteristic features of rebels, adventurers, and however, this is not yet a kind of consolidated class. It's not self-conscious of itself as a group. It's only towards the end of the 18th century that this consciousness, really speaking, emerges. And here I'd request Professor Prakash to also comment on Arnold Kettle's views, I think, on the novel.
Kettle, I think, the 20th century Marxist thinker, he would refer to this in the sense, that the novel becomes a kind of voicing the sense of rebellion, rejection. And one of the forms that the 18th century novel took, as you have indicated, you used the word mock there, that mocking the privileged, mocking the established people, and putting somebody else as an alternative to them, the ordinary person, who would always have a kind of critical glance at the upper classes. And privilege in the 18th century would mean nearness to the court or owning of the land in the villages. And both these people are cut off from the masses. So when the novel takes to the masses and expresses their opinion, then definitely the masses are looking back at the lords and are pricking the bubble of their honor, as you pointed out, and then, till the 17th century to be the theme of the literary writing. So novel in a way socializes the form of literature. And in fact, I'd like you to tell us something about the form of the novel, because as a genre, as a story, as a long thing, it has been there since time earlier. But the form that is assumed, the form of of the unconnected kind of details, and themselves they appear to be a part of the literary writing, that is the case with the novel. And this kind of a loose form where things are unconnected, this was there much earlier in human history when the epic was there. Mm. Epic had many episodes, epic had many characters, and some of the characters were not directly connected, and yet people were entertained. So I would like you to reflect upon the idea of vastness, on the idea of comedy, on the idea of the common masses. And that seems to be at the back of the evolution of the novel. What do you say?
Yes, absolutely. I if you look at it in the 18th century, it also emerges as something that's in a sense anti-romantic. The whole idea of the chivalric romance that was there, it kind of emerges as against that, and of course also against in a sense the clearly defined forces of feudalism it is marked by a kind of verisimilitude that allows it to look at different aspects of lived society. And one of the most famous definitions is given by Fielding, who calls it a comic epic poem in prose. So the use of the epic clearly indicates that the structure of the novel is it's loosely structured. It allows that kind of space in which not just only one particular group, which is why I earlier said that ordinariness in varied forms and in various forms. So various social groups, and not just the ordinary, but I think all of society in a sense, and looking at it from the point of view of realism, finds a kind of space within the novel, which really speaking can't be seen. The only other precedent I can think to this is maybe in the plays by Shakespeare, but as a novel, I think as a genre, it has that scope, it has that vast canvas in which different voices are kind of allowed to emerge. And I think Fielding aptly calls it a comic epic poem. Now comic clearly again shows that a lot of the established so-called virtues, established ideas or norms that govern the society, all of these are going to be in a sense challenged through the comic form, through the use of humor. And humor also makes it very interesting, because there's a kind of also a genial tone that allows us to laugh in a sense at human foibles and follies. So and of course the language remains that of prose. So just in these four or five words, Fielding, I think, kind of very aptly expresses this whole idea of the comic epic poem in prose, and explains the structure of the novel. So which really in a sense makes one wonder that how relevant in a sense, and we I would really like to ask, how relevant do you think is the definition provided by Fielding in the 18th century, and does it still hold for us today?
It's a very problematic definition, and I think that this requires a whole lecture to go into it, and maybe we can take it up in the other lecture that we have plans for to present. For instance, I'm struck by the word poem in prose. So I'd like to know, poem and prose are two different things, but here he's putting them together. So that's a nice idea. But as we close the lecture, I'd like you to, give in two or three lines the gist of what you have said.
So, in locating the rise of the novel in the 18th century, it's important to focus on the rise of a new class of people that really need representation. And because this is a new group of people that's increasingly becoming important, that the existing genres, be it that of poetry or drama, in a sense, are not conducive to kind of provide that kind of representation. And it is the novel as a genre that presents the ordinary in the language of the common people.
I think with this discussion, we come to the end of the lecture, in which Dr. Payal Nagpal has gone back to the 18th century to tell us as to how conditions made it necessary for the writers to take to a different kind of mode of writing, and that mode later on came to be called as the novel in general. So with this lecture, we come to the end of this, and thanks, Dr. Payal Nagpal, and viewers, think about these points and just mull them over and make your own conclusions. Thank you.